Throughout the world of Fallout, the player can find a number of strange locations, creatures, and factions. Some are completely rational, while others are downright ridiculous. But have you ever wondered where the developers draw the line? In today's video, we'll be taking a look at the Slanter, as well as what these creatures are, how they came to be, and of course, learn the reason as to why they never made it into the final version of Fallout 1. The Burrows is a small farming and hunting community founded in 2101 by a group of intelligent raccoons, known as the Slanter. Slanter basically means kindred. These creatures are highly intelligent, not only understanding the use of basic tools and weapons, but also possessing the ability to speak fluent English. Their homes consist of two varying builds. The first would have been on the surface and adobe-like in shape. These would have surrounded a giant fallen log at the center of their settlement, and the second would have been a system of interconnecting underground dwellings that encompassed the entire town, their entrances camouflaged among the vegetation for safety. Think Viet Cong spider hole. Now, the origins of these creatures can actually be discovered during the Brotherhood of Steel side quest, Become an Initiate, where the player has to travel to the West Tech Research Facility, or what's left of it, and bring back something from their venture as proof. After taking anti-rads and using a rope to get inside, the player can travel downwards to level 5, where a particular locker can be seen. Inside is the FEV experiment disc that we can read using our Pip-Boy 2000. It reads, January 12th, 2076. With batch 11-011, we have improved the mitotic cycle efficiency by 43%. We have infected 53 raccoons with the new strain. In addition to the now expected size increase, behavioral tests confirm an increase in intelligence and manual dexterity by 19 points on the Skuller Cap Index. Unfortunately, several subjects escaped confinement and had to be hunted down. Major Barnett ordered the remaining subjects to be terminated. However, two pairs were unaccounted for. This disc is the only piece of remaining evidence that confirms that the Burrows and the Slanter were more than just a mere thought. As for the two pairs that escaped the research facility, they headed northwest until 2101, where they discovered a small oasis thick with lush jungle forest thanks to a nearby river providing the earth with a steady supply of water. The raccoons then began creating the Burrows and, sometime later, named themselves the Tribe of the Slanter. It's worth mentioning that when they escaped from the facility, they stole an assortment of books. It was by using these they were able to learn English and gain an understanding of humans. The first buildings the Slanter made were similar to human dwellings. Their leader, Nares Kaa, remembered what the humans had done to him and made it pretty clear that their new home would not mirror that of a human city. From there on, the buildings were created using branches, sticks, and leaves, a more natural setting. As the Slanter bred and the Burrows grew, many of the Slanter became curious about the outside world and began sending small parties to explore the surrounding area. In 2106, one of these parties met a group of raiders from the Jackal tribe. As soon as the Slanter were spotted, they were fired upon, with many being wounded and even killed. The few who made it back to the Burrows explained to the others what had happened, and the community was divided. Some wanted to protect themselves against the humans and rigged the area around the Burrows with traps, also creating an underground system of tunnels that could be quickly accessed through hidden entrances. This group was known as the Den Dwellers, who quickly became the more animalistic of the two sides, and the other group, called the Top Dwellers, built their homes around the Great Tree. There were instances of humans entering the town. Whether they were friendly or not wasn't questioned by the Den Dwellers, who immediately attacked and killed them, just as the Jackals had done to them. Despite these differences, the Slanter didn't seem to mind all that much. They still lived in harmony with one another, with both groups united beneath the leadership of Nares Kaa, who allowed them to do pretty much anything they wanted, provided they didn't break the simple rules that had been established. These rules were clear: do not harm or kill another tribe member without having their crimes done onto them. Simply put, an eye for an eye. Property belongs to the group and no individual. Homes, however, are territorial, so one must not enter another's home without permission, lest it be taken to the head council. If any of these rules were broken, the perpetrator would be ostracized until the next moon, approximately 1 month. During this time, the other members would disregard their entire being. In other words, the guilty would be given the silent treatment by the entire town. As for the original slanter, they became known as the Old Ones. The Old Ones never told any of the others what had transpired at the West Tech Research Facility. The experiments, the escape, all of this was kept a secret. All that was ever said was where they originally came from. At some point, one of the Old Ones tried to return to the facility, perhaps to free the others who were left behind, not knowing they were already dead, or perhaps to retrieve more guides and technology for the tribe to learn from. During this attempt, the Old One saw a great glow on the horizon and decided to turn back. From then on, the place would forever be referred to by the tribe as the Glow. When the last of the Old Ones died, many of the younger slanter started wondering where they had come from. During the Great Winter of 2130, many of the slanter perished from the cold and lack of resources. Minishin, the new leader, gave them hope by creating the religion of the Glow. Minishin told the tribe that the gods inhabited the Glow and that these same gods had been the ones who created them. There was, of course, non-believers, but Minishin convinced them using the journals the Old Ones had stolen during their escape. Even after the winter had ended and times were no longer as tough, Minishin allowed the others to continue believing in their false gods. Sadly, in 2150, Minishin died without telling anyone that the religion was a fabrication intended to give the tribe hope. There were slanter who tried visiting the Glow to see these gods for themselves, but the radiation was too intense. For a decade, many continued to try, some never returning. That was until 2161, when a slanter had finally managed to make it back. Before succumbing to severe radiation poisoning, he stated, "There are no gods, only death." This, as you can imagine, divided the boroughs once again, with the den dwellers being the zealous believers, while the top dwellers were far more skeptical. This divide brought the tribe to the brink of a civil war. And this is where the player would have entered the boroughs. Upon entering, Renar, the present leader of the tribe, would explain the current state of the community, also saying that the player is the first human in 60 years to hold a conversation with the slanter. Renar has a simple request for the Vault Dweller: go to the Glow and return with proof that the gods are nothing more than human scientists. If the player has yet to find the Glow, a den dweller by the name of Mech can guide them there. Now, the quest would result in the player returning with a diary as proof. The top dwellers would then give them loyalty, while the den dwellers would give them respect. This would also defuse the civil war and bring peace back to the tribe. There was also going to be a number of side quests, such as the woodcutter's wife, to catch a wisp, and the trade line. Through these, the player would face off against an insane survivalist who stole the leader's daughter thinking she's his wife, returning a lost child who was stolen by the jackals and sold off to a traveling caravan of circus performers, and setting up trade routes between the boroughs and other settlements such as the Hub and Junktown. As you can tell, there was a lot of thought put into this, so let's take a look at why it never made it into the final release of the game. Developer Tim Kane said the location was written by an early designer associated with the project, and while it was well written, he felt that its content was not appropriate for the Fallout universe, mainly based on its style and feel in the game, and not on its artistic merit. Lead designer Chris Taylor said he always felt it didn't fit in with the rest of the game. It was a finely designed area, and would have brought more depth to the Glow, but it just didn't seem like Fallout. And developer Scott Campbell said, while Brian was off and running, writing quests for our furry editions, the artists had a meeting concerning the number of characters in the game. Due to time constraints, they had actually designed more than they could animate, so a compromise was needed. Since the mutant animals were rare, required several sets of armor, and needed totally different animations from the other human characters, they were removed first. So despite being this brilliant, albeit strange, tribe of talking raccoons that not only brought depth to other locations and to other factions, that had a well-written and unique origin that was both interesting and lore-friendly, were simply removed due to not having enough time, and more importantly, didn't fit in. Yeah, that doesn't sit right with me either. Mutated animals are nothing new, and there are instances of other creatures possessing the ability to hold a conversation, such as the talking deathclaws from Fallout 2, and the animals from Fallout 76, given the right circumstances, that is. So was the thought of intelligent raccoons really all that hard to believe? Be sure to show your support by liking the video and subscribing if you haven't already for more Fallout content. If there's anything you would like to see in a later video, leave a comment and I'll see what I can do. With that said, thank you, as always, for watching, and I'll see you in the next adventure.